Thank you. 那这个是什么？喂，
要吃吗？嗯，
Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Ed Lundquist, and on behalf of Institute of Oral History, I would like to thank everybody because I think it's the most popular lecture in this series of oral lectures that the Art History Institute has been organizing for a couple of years already. So thank you for coming, and I would like to extend a very warm welcome to our guest, the esteemed Professor Kenneth Frampton. And we actually planned this lecture already in 2012 when there was 20th anniversary of the Institute of Art History. But it didn't work out then, but we are equally happy to have you and have Professor Frampton here in Tallinn in 2015. And I would like to invite
of the Academy of Arts, Professor Ralph Kahn, to have a short introduction.
Welcome to everybody. It's a great honor for me to introduce you one of the most prominent architecture historians of our age. Professor Kenneth Frampton is very rich and British, who have studied in London at AA school. But since 1965, he has lived in the United States. First, he worked there at the Princeton University, and he has himself said that these first years there in the United States changed his mind a lot, and he became much more political. Of course, these were the years where he was in close connection with other leading historians and researchers of architecture, like Keith Reisman, who was there, and Agnes Anthony Wheeler, and several others. Since 1972, he has worked in Columbia University, where he still is. And in 1973, he was one of the first authors of the prominent Ready compositions. We know him best for his book, Modern Architecture Critical History, which was published by Thames and Hudson in 1980. And it took for him more than 10 years to write it. And as much as I know, it was the idea of Robert Middleton to commission it. And we know Robert Middleton well as a historian of the 19th century architecture, especially for his work about the French academicism. In his book, he broadened the scope of modern architecture really wide. If Reinhard Bentham or Guillaume only have mainly concentrated to the focus on the avant-garde history, but starting from Kenneth Frampton, a lot of architecture, of course, outside of this main modernist wave, was also seen, like the Torricism in Scandinavia, which he always had liked, or Latians in New Delhi, or architecture in America, or architecture of totalitarian regimes, etc. So this was much more nuanced history, what do we saw in his main book. But Kenneth Frampton, who has been influenced very much by philosopher Hannah Arendt, and who heard also from Martin Heidegger, for him always the creation of place and the context has been very important, and especially in his Spiritual Originalism article from 18, or more manifesto-like article from 1983, which is still very favorable to him. He put like a counterbalance to that then very trendy postmodernism on a local context, and he started to see again the architects which were still modernist, but deeply rooted in social, political context of their country. And then in 1995, another important trend in his interests, it's the interest in tectonics, took shape in the book Studies on Tectonic Culture, that was published then in 1995, where he looked through the history of modern architecture through the lens of structure. And there are fantastic chapters, especially I personally have liked the chapter on Auguste Perret, and how he, as a now old generation, was our influenced architect, how he perceived the modern architecture. And then, in the beginning of this century, he has published several monographs on architects like Alvaro Siza. And on the basis of his teachings, his most recent book is about the comparative. The comparison of several well-appeared iconic buildings of modern architecture. If this is the short introduction to this research in general, but then I must update it to the Estonian context. And here in the auditorium, there is a lot of students in architecture, and here is the book that I bought in London when I was getting scholar there in 1991. And this book has been a big eye opener for me, a young post-communist scholar. And well, for those who have visited my lectures in the History of Modern Architecture, they were mainly based on Kenneth Frampton's book, which I consider more valuable than Guillaume or Jürgen Jörnicke, whom I had read in Soviet time in Russian. So this book was a really valuable piece for all of us. And that's the reason why the Estonian Academy of Arts decided to translate this book. And I am happy that both of the translators, Ingrid Woody and Ivan Everby, are also here today. And also, you have a chance, for those who have not yet obtained the book, it's on sale there outside of the main hall, and I hope that tonight you can get also Postal's signature to the book. So I'm really happy that Professor Tina Frampton is finally here, and I would like to pass the floor over to you.
Yeah, I think I need to do this.
Yeah.
Can people hear me then? Like this? Works for a long. Okay, right. Thank you. Well, I've never been here before. I've only been here for a few hours, and I will leave tomorrow evening around 6 o'clock, so it's all a bit too fast. And but I wanted to come here. Be here and also to see something of the city, etc. Because I came to Finland and I've been to Finland a number of times, but I've never been here. And yes, and so the reason why I came to Finland is that I was invited to give this memorial Niels Erik Wickman lecture. And so then, of course, I accepted. But as always, when accept things like this, you then have the next moment you wonder what you should say. You know, what would be, what should I say? And I thought at some point I would give something, like for example, with the subject of my this recent book, which has just been published by Lars Muller, which I don't have here, which was a record of a sort of game I played in teaching architecture students for a long time. Comparing chronological buildings, you know, from more or less of the same scale, same practical program, but from different ideological standpoint. And I always began this seminar with two buildings, one of which was the Riedwald Schroeder House and the Maison Cook. So that was one possibility, but I somehow decided, maybe not wisely, that I would try to present something about Finland, and so I, and that's what this lecture is about. Ostensibly, that's what this lecture is about. And so it has a title, Homage à Finlandia, and then finished subtitle, Finnish Architecture and the Unfinished Modern, Finnish Architecture and the Unfinished Modern Project. And I've given this lecture once before in Helsinki a few days ago, and I'm giving it for the second time now. And of course, one never gives, fortunately, it's impossible, I think, the same lecture twice. You give something like the same lecture, but of course, it's not the same. And some versions that are better than others. I hope this is a bit better. Anyway, it's a bit shorter. Because I got very uptight about giving this lecture in Helsinki. with this topic. So I started to write it because I got very nervous about it. And so I wrote a 9.5-page piece, which I'm not going to read. I didn't read it there either. And I will read even less here, but happily a bit or two, perhaps. But, so why, maybe I should go back one step further, which is in the last academic year, a Finnish architect whose name I can't possibly pronounce, but it is something like Andy Nujokin, I think, I was a fairly young group, three of them, I think they have the practice under the name of ALA, I think, and they won this competition for the city library in Helsinki, which is now already beginning to be built, facing onto the parliament. I thought this, I still think it was a totally meaningless piece, totally meaningless. So, in my opinion, of course, it's very subjective, you could say, and arrogant on top of it. But I thought that this was not, this wasn't the building that really answered the problem of what is a library now, you know, with the hybrid condition of books and the digital. But that wasn't the only problem, because what is a library in terms of the society? And their answer, in a way, is a kind of very populist answer to make a library which is like a very much very open-ended community center, as far as I can see. And then, there are books, of course, but there is a sort of book stack, etc., etc. But the different component parts, you know, are very unclear, it seems to me, or more importantly, maybe, the question of what is the city library facing onto the parliament, like that problem. Well, there are two problems. One is, what is a library in the age caught between digital and books? And what is a library facing the national parliament? What is the city library facing the national parliament? I think these objects are not able, or, well, not really able. Society, not able to formulate the question and not able to answer it either, or double it. And so the work has this kind of, well, it's spectacular, of course, sort of spectacular. But for me, I don't know what one can say more or less. Maybe I should just stop talking about it. So unless, what I'm not going to talk about here anyway, except I've already talked about it. Anyway, what is the departure for me was, for this thing, Amara and Landy, was this group that I had a long time. I dated 1992. It was an exhibition in the Museum of Finnish Architecture with the title An Architectural Present, Seven Approaches. And I will talk a bit about that book. And maybe more importantly, about the questionnaire that was given to these seven different practices. I mean, they were Elaine Zitunen, Heike-Lene Kovanen, Libeska, Kari Jaakinen, Timo Babalainen, Georg Grun, etc. And they were also all asked the same question. And it was a question that I only actually, after writing this and then giving the lecture in Helsinki, I realized that the questions are full of doubt. And this was a generation, you could say, that came to their maturity, you know, after the death of Aalto in the 70s. Less than a decade later, they had started to, do work and make names. In fact, some of them, of course, had started even before that. But I think of them as, I thought of them as a post-mortem generation. I'm showing this book, which of course is the Modern Architectural Critical History, and I'm showing it for obvious reasons, publicity, but as if it were necessary, but not really. I mean, this is the first edition is published in 1980. And it's only later that I realized that it was published in the same year as the 1980 Paolo Portoghese Venice Biennale, which is, in a way, you could say, the beginning of postmodernism as a style, you know, 1980. And yes, and it shocked me to realize that the book is published at the same time, you know, that it's the same time as a postmodern thing. Why? Because I've sort of always thought of myself, well, I belong to a generation that still believed in the modern project, that I've sort of thought of myself, perhaps I still do, as someone who's committed to the modern project, and also as it concerns art. And yet, it's published at exactly the same time that as it happens, that there is this exhibition of 1980. And I wanted to say one other this is the catalogue, from the finished catalogue and up, you know, seven approaches, an object for present, of 1992. And I want to say that I shall play around a bit, maybe too much, with dates, because maybe it's to do with my age, but I think that dates, you know, it's strange the way certain events happen, and they do have a kind of influence, you know, on each other, etc. And I've often said to myself that history is a bit like a wave, the breaking of which you can't see, you know. That what you think is over is not over, or, you know, things which you sort of think may be preordained have a kind of particular point where they begin, etc. Why won't you say this here in Estonia, maybe where there's so many beginnings and endings of relatively recent date, not, maybe it's redundant, of course, it's perhaps redundant. And, but the interesting thing that before, you know, the 1980 Venice Biennale, which by the way was the first Venice Biennale in art ever, which had this slogan, the end of prohibition and the presence of the past. One year before that, Jean-François Lyotard publishes this book in French, of course, called The Postmodern Condition. It's a French leftist intellectual who thinks that the modern project is not the grand narrative of the modern project, which also means, of course, the project of the Enlightenment is no longer possible. I think basically is the message of that book. And so that also comes 1 year before I published my own thing. And as I've already said, this 1992 book, there's another by an American, enthusiastic young American artist on Finnish architecture, published in the same year, 1992, somebody named Scott Poole. And I was going to read, but I can't because I realized I left it behind, but that's all right, so this thing won't go on so long. In a preface that a British artist called Colin Sylvan Wilson wrote to this book, he talks about, you know, he talks with envy, in fact, about being looking at finished work. I mean, he was familiar with, not only with Aldo, but with young finished work, youngish finished work, before he wrote the preface to this book. And in fact, he's part of a small circle, really, in Cambridge, England, Sir Leslie Martin, Colin Sylvan Wilson, a colleague of mine, Patrick Hodgkinson, etc., who, in a way, influenced by Hodgkinson, tried to develop in Cambridge and in practice, not only in the school, a kind of a brick architecture that would be more appropriate to a British climate, but still be a kind of modern brick architecture. And he writes in the preface to this book, you know, he compares, you know, the British who seem, you know, have endless problems with regard to the accessibility of modern architecture in relation to the British public, versus his idealization of the British culture, where, you know, the architects seem to have particularly a privileged position in relation to society. That's the basic gist of his preface. But in this preface, he also mentions Habermas, He mentions Habermas's book. Yes, Towards a Rational Society, published in 1967, and actually carries in it a very important essay called Technology and Science as Ideology. And later, he will, soon after the student revolt in 68, Habermas will write a piece on modern architecture and will criticize the, no, sorry, that comes later. He will criticize the event of postmodernism after the 1980 Biennale, before its retreat from the modern project. Habermas reacts to the Venice Biennale against this postmodern style. And Wilson, writing the introduction to the point that I showed previously, remarks on that basically says, you know, that this is not, that the Finnish architects, of course, have not taken this journey. They have not retreated from the modern project, unlike the what follows. But actually, I might tell you something personal about me and the Venice Biennale, because Robert Stern, whom I talked with in Colombia, was one of the commissioners for Paulo Portuguese's Venice Biennale, and he invited me to go to this Biennale, to a first meeting, to a planning meeting, I think, in 79. I went there and I understood what was going on, and I resigned, which of course didn't please him. So I had some, you know, negative involvement with the Biennale even before it happened. If you take these dates, 1980 Biennale, 1992, and the show Seven Approaches in the Museum of Architecture in Helsinki, and the same year this book, Anglo-American, if you like, appraisal of Finnish architecture. What I realized only through working on the writing this piece, working on this damn thing, because I had this book, 1992, for a long time, but I never looked at the sort of interrogation, the questions that were asked of all these architects by the Museum of Finnish Architecture, in which they question them on two points, basically. One is, what is the influence of history on your work, you know, in a way picking up on the postmodern style of the Venice Biennale? And what is the impact of technology? And these two questions perhaps caused them the most, was the most disturbing questions that they had to deal with. And I will just touch on some of their responses in this. As I've already said, actually, I didn't mention the name of the perhaps most prominent practice, which is this practice of Gullickson-Kaillerman formula. This book by Gustavo Gili, as a survey of that practice, was published in 1990, 2 years before the museum exhibition. It was, and to some extent still is, an interesting practice. I will try to characterize that practice briefly, and to talk about some of their responses. The practice was Christian Gullickson, Erkki Kaijo, and Timo Folker. Timo Folker being definitely the younger of this team. I have here a little note that I sort of bypassed, but I don't want to bypass anymore, which is in 1979, which takes us back to the year of the Lyotard postmodern condition. Margaret Thatcher, there is no alternative Thatcher, is elected Prime Minister of the UK. And you could say, from the point of view of the UK anyway, that neoliberalism starts right there. And I mean, similar political change takes place at the States, but it's more significant, I think, the appointment of Thatcher to this power position in 79. And I think you can say that the Nordic welfare state, which I know in many ways is obviously not possible for Estonia to be part of the Nordic welfare state, but the Nordic welfare state, and the welfare state in general, rather than just qualifying it by Nordic, was already under siege from this point onwards. And so this is also part of the changing political climate, you know, in which this questionnaire to these leading Finnish architects appeared. And it's an interesting thing that Collins and Wilson, who will also write the introduction to this book, will remark on the fact that there are two kinds of architectures represented in this practice of three people. One is Christian Gubitzer's preference for a wall architecture, shown here in one of his many parish centers and churches, and one is this kind of emerging high-tech architecture in Finnish practice, which above all, of course, concerns Kyra. So this is Gubitzer's wall architecture, another church, and yes, we get more of the same. It's 1979 to 83, and I will in a minute show you that this position that Gubitzer adopted was not the first, was not characteristic of his very first work. This is also part of the same complex, 1979 to 83. But a couple of years later, Erkki Kaarma makes this housing West End Espoo. It's 1982, and you can see from the way, you know, the conservatory and the balconies and the railings, you know, laid on top of a kind of cubistic structure. Same thing here, same complex. What's significant, I think, and I would like myself to think more about that, is what is the difference between the Anglo-American high-tech, which starts, by the way, in 72, say, with the Sartre Pompidou in Paris competition, Rogers Piano, right? And that whole line of development, Norman Foster, Richard Rogers, Renzo Piano, which I call Anglo-Italian high-tech, and this kind of Finnish high-tech, there is a real difference. And what exactly is that difference? I think it's an interesting thing to pursue. I mean, it's clear that, you know, I would say just straight away, that the Anglo-Italian high-tech is not looking to the Russians at all. I don't think so. But the Finnish high-tech is looking at, you know, well, the Russian avant-garde is the 20s, you know, the Soviet avant-garde. And this project, which was made by all three partners, the addition to Stockholm in Helsinki, 84 to 89, is not quite so constructivist, but more of the same. But in the early, very first beginnings of Gubitzer's practice, he and Johanni Palasmanttu work on this prefabricated house system, which is not, yes, there is some precedent for that in the Russian avant-garde, but I think perhaps more precisely is that the Vaxman Gropius General Palace System house that is perhaps on their minds. But in any case, this is a wooden house, prefabricated wooden house, and it shows Gubitzer in a kind of more younger, yes, you could say, quote-unquote, more avant-gardist moment, 73. Or this, which is also the same, but not by Gubitzer, but by Cairo, is the textile works of Mary Mecca, 71, 74. And so this is this complex practice, and Kairo doesn't answer the questionnaire. It's not his Good and speaks for all three of them in answering the questionnaire, and you know, has great doubts about what is the significance of new technology, but thinks that it is a kind of, yes, more or less a kind of fashion which doesn't guarantee anything about the durability of update or the significance of update over time. And that's basically his response to this question. He doesn't really deal with the question of history, he deals with the question of technology. The other architect that is particularly interesting is Yuval Nadeshka, who, with an older Finnish architect called Petter Salmio, designs this in 64, right? You know, it's already 10 years before the first work of Gulix and Karo and Formula. It's a Kubala town hall. It's still there, I think, but has been very badly treated. What saddens me about this building, which you don't find, by the way, in many surveys of Finnish architecture, is that how rational it is. You know, it's kind of Italian rational. And it intrigues me, this, for example, where, you know, the two grids of the city come together, and it's self-evident, but I think this 45-degree chain is the way they offset the piazza from the body of the building. But this is before the Visca, all those churches on the Visca, which are obviously, to some extent, inspired by Dutch neoclassicism. Zelenska was not really not attracted by the Russian legacy at all, not attracted by the high tech, the Anglo-Italian high tech either. And with the Sanya produces this very superbly proportioned rationalist exercise. And I'm showing here the work of Simo Paavilainen and Simo and Kappi Paavilainen. Maybe there was a building there on the Olari Church in Espoo in 1981. And the idea I like, which is of course you could say Altoesque in itself, is this notion that of uses the term of breaking the building into its site. And you see here, you know, the way it is broken into its site. I mean, it's not broken with the finesse, maybe, of Alto himself, but you can see that there is this dimension. And the other thing that fascinates me about this work, as distinct from Gulitzer or Blackhatton and Leska, or Cairo, is this this use of brickwork. I mean, maybe it's the most, I don't know their work completely, but I think it's maybe the most significant, it's 1981, it's maybe the most significant work of their lives, where the back of the church, which is like a kind of broken back, is an exercise, is a tectonic exercise. It is a poetical construct. These buttresses and the cuts in the wall, and the interplay between the cuts, the buttresses, and the precision brickwork, I think is a kind of poetical construction. And I suppose the simplest, for me, it can become more complicated. But the simplest thing to say, to be said about what the hell is tectonic is a good question. My only answer is, in a very general sense, of course one could answer in more specific ways over a longer period of time, but I think it is above all this question of a poetic construction. And I think this issue of poetic construction remains as Well, I will come at the end to talk about a holding operation as an essential part of a holding operation. And Pavlov says, you know, that there is no Finnish identity other than coming off the a site from Finland, of the topography of the site and the climate. The figure of Rosenfeld, which is part of the 70 approaches, and this is a sauer by Rosenfeld. I think this is also the 1982, something like that, 1982. Well, it's almost pure vernacular, you know. You can see from this plan, for example, that it is like the blockhouse tradition. The Finnish blockhouse tradition is slightly reinterpreted. And the section through the sink, turf on the roof, an important issue. And in his response to the question about history, he gives us kind of a Zen-like response. He says that history is inseparable, is a sailing ship inseparable from the wind blowing forward. I think that's a very beautiful idea, I think. And elsewhere, he talks about culture being like a string of pearls. He shifts the metaphor. And then he says, you can add to the string of pearls, but above all, the string must not be broken. And then he says, but this has already happened in Finland. This is 1992. And actually, soon after this, Rosenfeld ceases to be an object. And now he reminded me, now just now, that all this, I can't remember exactly when, I must have said to him, well, I suppose it's somewhat after the 1992 exhibition, that, you know, I think he should keep being an object, but he stopped doing objects and started with films. And now when I was in Helsinki, he said, well, I've gone back to Huffington again. I did what he wanted me to do. But, of course, in the interim, he has made, so I told, a lot of successful films. And this is his work, this is the kind of work he was doing, which is almost, I mean, he's obviously very inspired by Alto and by Alto's interpretation of the vernacular, but I mean, unlike Alto, it is almost pure vernacular. And unlike this building, by Kari Gavin, who, by the way, has very similar things to say. Oh, it's also very doubtful about technology. I mean, here you can see that this is actually a school. It's also an S school. It's so-called Suna school. The date is 1985. I didn't say that these works are 1986 of Gutenberg. This is 85 by Jarvin and S school. And he, he equates history with tradition. He says somewhere, there is nothing new. There's, so one should stop trying to invent new things. One should do work which arises out of the condition. I would say, again, landscape, technique. And he is as doubtful about kind of advanced technology as Gulliksen. But I particularly, well, I think this book, this building is manifests this poetic construction in a way which is different, of course, from the Paavolainen brick church. And I mean, these rooms, of course, the withstanding themes, this dyed, this wall dyed. But among these seven approaches is the practice of, well, there are two practices that I see in the answers to questions and in the works somehow are different from all the others. One is the practice of Pekka Helene and do Zitunen, and the other is the practice of Heineken and Kommen. And this is quite different from, well, from Ilveske, from Jaapinen, who, by the way, had also worked for this Sanio. I didn't know, I still don't know what it is that was so significant about Sanio. And is different from other language also. And it is this is 1983. It's the winning competition entry for Nokia Office. It's by Helene Stuhl. What is this? You know, I don't fully understand what I'm looking at, of course, I have to admit. You know, I mean, it's not as pretty, but these, I suppose, are the offices. This is a sort of central atrium. Actually, it's interesting because he's just completed the building for the, this is an appendix building, adjunct building to the Finnish Parliament. And when I suddenly, I saw it recently, and now when I look back at this project, I realize that there is a certain continuity between the building he just completed on his own, Elaine, and this building, in that, you know, these are individual offices, but I suppose these are breakout spaces for these individual offices, and this is the nature so that these offices, of course, are lit internally, and these are lit externally, well, there are two floor levels, and there is some kind of, you know, synthesis, access across, and I don't understand what all this is, I have to admit. Very elegant roof structure. But what impressed me most about this thing is that it is it's very typological in its approach. That is, yes, the architect is looking to kind of consolidate the type, you could say invent, consolidate, and the witch. And that's more striking in this work of Elaine Stuhlen, I think. And also there is some, well, you already can get a glimpse of the, you know, Finnish high tech again with much, yes, much more systematic and modular than the work of Cairo. Yeah, I feel like going back to show you the work of Cairo, but I'm not going to do it. And this work would get to be built into this mega. Whether the I don't know whether the typology is the same or not. You know, it's built. I think it takes them to 10 years to build this thing out. 1994 with this booming Nokia Corporation, which the section. Well, you see, the ancients have clearly changed. The purity of the initial typological dimension is obviously no longer there. It's curtain wall stuff. It's very thin. And the one virtue, I think, that is present, for me anyway, and I'll come back to it at the end, is this presence of wood. And also maybe the refinement of the detail. This kind of refinement. I mean, I think you can look at the work of Piano and Rogers, etc. You won't find that kind of delicacy. So one of the differences. But Helene, would actually they would do this building. This building would be built in this building in Hestra, the so-called Hestra estate in Sweden, which I've never seen. I think it would be worth seeing, but so far I didn't make it. It's near a town called Boras, and an axonometric of it looks like that. It's an apartment building with this central cleft, a space running down the middle of it, and it seems to me, looking at it, it's called incidentally, Sibelius Bach. And it looks like that, perhaps you already know it. I mean, it's a very appealing image, this white building with these tough roofs. And it, you know, standing in the middle of this forest. And but recently I talked to Elaine about it because, you know, it suggests that this is a kind of communal space. And I don't have it in the images, but there is a kind of glass sort of conservatory running up the center of the building, which implies that there is a collective element down there. And she told me that the original plan was to put a children's daycare into the below, you know, on the grade level, covered by this glass. And of course, you can oversee it from this gallery. And but the children's daycare was never built. He said the builder was not interested in that, and no one else was. It's very, and when then one asks also, the town manager, the guy managing the estate, I think it was called Hansen, the whole thing was supposed to demonstrate a new Nordic housing platform. And yes, so I don't know, it obviously wouldn't be worth looking at, but you know, it sounds like one of these, talk about unfinished modern project. I mean, this is, somebody makes an attempt at a modern project, but it gets unfinished before it can even be started. And I learned, again from the net, just recently, that now, we don't know why, I don't know why anyway, this turf has been taken off. So, it's even, not only is it unfinished, it's deconstructed already. And but nevertheless, there is a difference, I think, between the Helene Sipunen version of Hayek and the version of Aikinen Kommonen, because I'm showing now this this airport in Rovaniemi that was already yes, it was a project in 1992. It would be finished soon afterwards. And it also has you know, it looks like a constructivist work, and yet there are all sorts of strange things like this sun and the lamp here, you know, covering the roof of the main reception room, which you know traces the path of the sun on the floor, and. It's a kind of popular scientific demonstration, and this quality, well, it appears in other work like this Finnish Science Center at Vantaa, which was built by 1992. This is illustration from 1992, separate approaches, and it had a plan like this, where you know certain components appear like these, and. They seem to be, you know, like elements that could have been in the work of Ivan Demidov, for example, in the late 20s in the Soviet Union. But there are, like this, for example, but there are kind of funny games to do with laser lights coming off masks. And I have this feeling that the work of these this practice was always. Looking to it, to turn somehow or other, turn the building into kind of large piece of art, you know, or alternatively, to use the building to as a kind of popular science demonstration. In both cases, as though the building itself was not enough, that you wanted to not just do building qua building, as though you know this particular partnership already had a certain anxiety. About whether or not the building was accessible to the society. Exactly the issue that Collins and Wilson, Sandy Wilson, so admired in the Finnish architecture, was already somehow, I think, a source of anxiety. And I wanted to compare, So, you know, I know very well Stephen Hall. I think he's a very talented architect. This, of course, is Stephen Hall's competition entry for the 1993 Museum of Contemporary Art, Helsinki, and which I knew I actually even saw the project in the office, Stephen Hall, when it was being designed. And I mean, every so often I get taken into that office and he asks my opinion, which he then doesn't take too seriously, fortunately. Anyway, I had not seen this building until a couple of days ago. And but before I saw the building, as I was working on what I would say in this lecture, I began to think about this question of reason and what place does reason have in the process of, you know, generating the architectural form. And you know, this so-called chiasma, which became the title of this form, one form turning up another, in relation actually playing, of course, facing on to the finished parliament. And with this kind of dynamic, beautiful work out by Hall, this dynamic spatial interior, more of the same here. And okay, one solution which wins the competition, and the one project that doesn't win the competition is by the best. Maybe there were others, but the one significant work, I think, which didn't win the competition is this piece. And this is the famous Mannerheim statue, and it's being driven somewhere around here. And this building is you know, it's underground, the whole museum. And this is its plan. And Mark Carl mentioned Hannah Arendt and my obsession with this book, The Human Condition, and this term of Earth, the space of public appearance. And you know, what you have in the Levesque project is quite clearly a space of public appearance. Also, of course, the auditorium. You go down into the sink. It's below the surface of the plaza. And these spaces are rational sort of top-lit spaces that can be played around with, flexible spaces for the exhibition of art. And I suppose you could say that there is something about the top line which maybe could be more subtly developed than they are in this model. But what is fascinating, I think, is this plan, and also what it perhaps has to say about the reason, rationality. And then how does the whole project stand up now built, for example, from the point of view of reason? And of course, the rationality isn't the only dimension, but I think that what is fascinating about this work is that the provision of public space, the fact that this is, well, you know, that's the point, but maybe I'm going around in circles. You know, there are many architects, including Frank Gehry and Richard Meyer and Hadid, Zaha, and we can go on, we can make this longer, you know, for whom a museum is, you know, very nice, building without a program at all. I can just do my thing, right? In fact, I mean, what has happened in many cases is that is you end up with an art museum where the biggest work of art is the building, and where the architect wishes to preempt the art, right, by doing the ultimate art piece instead of providing a building that is open and flexible to the exhibition of art. They want to do their number, and in a way, I think that the problem with Stephen's chiasma is still that problem. And when I went, is that problem? Because when I went to recently to the gallery, I realized that the circulation is kind of totally crazy. You can never find anything. You can't find yourself anywhere. You know, you constantly have to backtrack. Unlike this building, where you could probably always find everything and see And and I'm not going to talk about this very much, which is this written by an American, Peter McKee, published in 2005, Resolved Incorporated, Contemporary Architecture and Corporate Identity. And it is a kind of critique, if you like, of certain aspects of finished high tech. You know, it's obviously pointing to the Nokia triumph, to the Nokia Corporation, and to the role played by Pekka and May in relation to the Nokia Corporation. It's a kind of, it's also critical from a clearly from a political standpoint. And this is a sort of sign of the times in a way, you know, the extent to which corporations in general, apart from architecture, have more and more power in the globalized economy than in a way democratic, local democratic representation has, which brings me to this, you know, this is actually Harold Foster's anthology, The Anti-Aesthetic, published in 1983, in which this essay of mine appears, Towards a Critical Regionalism, 6 points for an architectural resistance. And 1983. Actually, among these points, I already, first of all, I suppose I should say that an inspiration behind this text, Towards a Critical Regionalism, 6 points for architectural resistance, is Paul Ricoeur's essay of 20 years before, bearing the title Universal Civilization and National Cultures, where he sets up a dialogical relationship between national culture, singular, you know, singular version of plurality of national cultures, and universal civilization, which he equates with universal technology. And he makes the argument from this essay that not all culture can possibly survive the impact of universal civilization, which, you know, he sees as universal technology. And it's in this essay that I first touch on this question of tectonic, where it's a construction, versus scenographic, you know, a representation, mise-en-scène. And, you know, those two aspects, the scenographic and the tectonic, are, yeah, they are probably both always present in architectural work. But if one, my opinion, if one dominates the other, you end up either with a kind of cold technical machine, or you end up with an image which has nothing behind it. And as in the stage set, so the play, this opposition, tectonic scenographic, is sitting right there. And, this whole attempt to qualify the word regionalism with the word critical is open to lots of argument, I suppose, maybe I could read one or two things that, since I cleverly disposed of my text, so up to now I didn't quote anything, which you must be very happy about. But, yes, what am I doing with it? Yes, okay. Right, so at some point, like 6 points, well, I kept on revising that, why not seven, that kind of game. Somewhere here, I guess. Yes. How many do I have here? I have seven. You know, I still have seven. The first one. And I'm not going to read the whole thing. But one, critical regionalism has to be understood as a marginal practice, one of which warranties critical of modernization, nonetheless, still refuses to abandon the emancipatory and progressive aspects of the modern architectural legacy. Two, in this regard, critical egoism manifests itself as a consciously bounded object, one which, rather than emphasizing the building as a freestanding object, places the stress on the territory to be established by the structure erected on the site. The place for it means that the object must recognize the physical boundary of its work as a kind of temporal limit, the point at which the present act of building stops. I mean, that's, I think, also a very important issue. It should lead one against the idea of making buildings as freestanding objects, but making buildings that are integrated into the ground and which run out to some idea of a boundary at which, really, the language I use here, the present act of building stops, because always, at some point, you know, the act of building stops. Three, critical realism favors the realization of objects as a tectonic fact, rather than the reduction of the built environment to a series of ill-assorted scenographic episodes. Four, it may be claimed that critical realism is regional to the degree that the invariably stressed is, sight, topography, light, climate, etc., etc. Then point five, critical realism emphasizes the tactile as much as the vision, hence, of course, this also plays a little bit in relation to tectonics and the graph. Or six, while opposed to the sentimental simulation of the local, the lack of critical realism will on occasion insert, reinterpret the natural elements. Well, of course, that's what Alton did, what Rosenfeld perhaps did, perhaps to extremes. And seven, critical realism tends to flourish in those cultural interstices which, in one way or another, are able to escape the optimizing thrust of universal civilization. Now, this is, this is the 2005 edition, and since then, of course, many things have happened, and the universal thrust, the thrust of universal civilization did not exactly go away, and this globalization goes on and on. And I just want to do two things. I want to have a bike on that matter. All right, I will stop soon. This, well, for obvious reasons, this is Africa. Somewhere here is Senegal and Guinea, and more clearly here is this. Yes. Senegal, Guinea. And I'm going to talk about, because it intrigues me, this is, of course, subsistence economy in Africa. And this is the house built in 1986 in Mali, in Guinea, built for, yes, a patron, Ella Kebekas. You may know about her already. But somehow or other was friends with someone named Alpha Diallo, who was an agronomist from Guinea, who, I don't know why, ended up in Helsinki, and even more extreme, decided to translate the Kalevala into his native language, Fula. And very weird things to do. But in 1984, he died, and she, I don't know whether this is another affair or not, but in any case, she brought his body back to Guinea, and very wealthy woman, and commissioned Marco Coleman to design a villa for her in Mali, in Guinea, which is currently here, and which is planned here, and also, sorry, because it's on this side, this is somewhat kindly planned, we could say, maybe, and then this, and then she sponsored a pottery farming school. That this is 1986 also, the plan of which is shown here, because this this Alpha Diallo said, the most important thing in Mali is to increase the intake of protein, and therefore chickens, you see, very good. And so this chicken farming school was made, which looks a bit like this, very simple block construction, and this extraordinary timber portico is, and the plan is like that, the portico is there. This is a lecture hall, these are various classrooms and some living facilities. And God knows where you actually have the chickens, but in any case, this is the story, and this is the this is the section, obviously, this is the portico, this is the classroom, not lecture hall, this is the kind of instruction that was being used, and this is, this thing is incredibly beautiful, this column in wood, by the way, with this wooden truss, painted blue, and this is the interior. You see the ties, trusses here, and this is the thing. We're looking at the front here, of course, and this is actually, this slide's a little bit mixed up, because this is her house. And we have a section like that, blocks again, tiles on the roof, a bamboo screen, which produces this kind of effect, and under certain conditions, and okay, project number one, Finnish architects working in Guinea. These is three women architects working in Senegal more recently. And it's a woman's center. So it's Sonia Holman, Jenny Reuter, and Helena Sandman, who actually, they started this project as students. Somehow or other, faculty in Senegal, they met these women, and they developed this project over, I think, quite a period of time. It's built in 1995, and it, you can see, well, there are buttresses here, but this is, all of this is concrete block walling with marked roofs, and to the courtyard, these are, some of these are production sheds, storage sheds, and assembly rooms, and a lot of the assembly takes place in the outside. This is it coming close to completion. This is the raw material. They transform this material by painting it red. And we see it here in this sort of matriarchal society. And the kind of materials that they're using. So unfinished model project, and then I said earlier, unfinished lecture. I mean, I didn't know how to finish this canvas, I've got one. I couldn't resist this, which is published in 1976 in England by Ernst Schumacher. Small is beautiful. 3 years before Margaret Thatcher gets elected, he had been an economist, German military economist, working for the National Coal Board before Margaret Thatcher got rid of the coal industry altogether. And this is a put there as a comment on this very strange Finnish work in the middle of Africa, and the sensitivity with which that work was carried out. And somehow, unfinished lecture, unfinished model project, this took me back to this book, which is the first book of architecture ever bought, which is actually a pirated book. There was a Swiss, actually, apparently there were a lot of Swiss who talked about it. He called them his Swiss guard. And the two of them were, kind of betrayed him in a sense, but not. Edouard and Claudia Neuschwander swept the staff off the table and went back to Switzerland. And also had their own photographs and published an amazing book called Alpha and Finnish Architecture. There are a series of projects, actually, many of them industrial, or like this for the Kahula glass beaks, where I'm intrigued by the economy of this. This almost standard truss on concrete. This is, for me, a little tectonic exercise on the concrete. And then, he does this game, which, transforms what would be a boring repetition into a plastic form that moves in a certain direction. And he would do that in a different way here in this what at the end is possible. Now, there's nothing high tech about this, except you could say that I'm into the construction. It's in its own way high tech, and these amazing timber arches. All of this is done, all this function that you know, these are works of 1951 or 1952, something like this. And this incredible game, you know, with the structure, several structure, but that gives the work a particular character. And let's see, same here. Or this, which I believe is a building that suffered quite a bit recently, but is a nothing building for an engineering association in the rock, in the fabric of Helsinki, the street fabric, and has this is a kind of restaurant on the top of the building with this this plastic hall gives a sudden honorific height to the building, made out of stuff like this. It couldn't be made out of a simpler product, and wood, of course, more the same in action. And of course, somewhere on the same building, you get the characteristic, his famous skylights. But in the same book is this plan for Imatra, which has intrigued me a lot. You know, never, as far as I know, carried out. And what I like about it is that it isn't, of course, a radiant city or some kind of Deutsche Industry Norman layout, you know, Zielenbau. But it is, you know, a mosaic, a kind of organic mosaic, in which presumably new works, new housing schemes, transit, etc., etc. It's worth somebody trying to analyze this thing in detail. This is Plan for Imatra, 1953. Yeah, paid for, of course, by the Finnish wood industry, pulp, paper, pulp, wood industry. That's the whole kind of Alstom empire, probably deeply involved in this commission. And it is the basis of Alstom coining the term, I think, forest town, in order to distinguish it from the, you know, Anglo-American garden city, as something particularly, I suppose, Finnish. Ending with three images and then a few general comments. This thing by Pekka Helén in the year 2000, Finn Forest Modular Office. The important thing, of course, is this hybrid synthesis of wood and metal, and in this case, is this Melamaki National Forest Museum in Pukaharu. I don't exactly know the date of this, but it's the same hybrid like work using wood, of course. You could say this also by Arne Usavoy. It's a salad for a very wealthy man, but this this kind of synthesis of wood and metal, between the shoes, the terrible image, but it's something that it's something that interests me a lot. And I'm going to end with some general comments. Okay, so what? Where are we going with this story? As I already indicated, I managed to be so stupid as to leave these notes that I kept prepared about how to end this damn unfinished lecture away. But let me just See, I think that, here's one project. Can it be finished? What do we mean exactly? I suppose it begs the whole question of what do we mean by modern, postmodern, anti-modern, and so on, modernization. There's a book written by this French philosopher, who I think a political scientist, philosopher Bruno Latour, published in 1991 with the title "We Have Never Been Modern," and he starts that book of his, 1991, with the fall of the Berlin Wall, 1989, which he sees as decisive. And what impresses me is it's 1 year, it's 10 years after Lyotard's postmodern condition, which is like a sort of giving up of the project. And And, you know, it begs the question of where we stand. I mean, you know, with the globalization, which has followed that, I mean, one of the triumph, it's hard to talk about here, I'm sure, the triumph of the West, of the American Pax Americana, you know, the fall of the Soviet Union, and the transformation of the Chinese People's Republic, has created a situation where capital flows around the world indifferently at the highest possible speed. It has created the globalized tradition. And paradoxically, even the European Union has become problematic in with regard to the globalized condition, as to some extent it was contributing to the globalization. I learned in Finland just now, for example, that the Finnish ceramic industry is really not in good shape at all. That the beautiful blue and brown and green tiles that Alta used on the national pension insurance building in Helsinki are no longer available, you know, because they can't, they don't produce them anymore. And the Maison Carré in Paris, for example, has a tile smoothing room, and one of the problems is to find is to restore that smoothing room today and to find ceramic tiles that are of disorder at the edge of the pool, because the industry no longer makes this kind of tile. And so we can, you know, we are in that situation. And one of the reasons why I ended with this, these sort of three images of wood now, is because a very interesting British critic of South African origin published a short essay entitled 10 Shades of Green, where he points out, you know, that wood from sustainably managed forests is the one material that is the least has the least embodied energy in its production. And timber is the least, brick is the least, and then you go rise up glass. Of course, the top of the scale is aluminum. Steel is pretty high up as well. And so, if we talk about sustainability as a kind of resistant principle, you know, the question of wood, I think, and building wood, you know, rises as an issue. You know, the one renewable building wood, I suppose brick is too, to some extent, but wood for sure is the one renewable resource. And it's rather crazy to end up a lecture like this talking about wood, but it's only what wood is itself, what wood stands for, right? And also wood, of course, used with other materials. So that what one is working with is a kind of hybrid architecture, which where there is a kind of, where the poetic construction is evident in the way these materials are put together. I mean, you know, on what grounds, how should we ground architecture today? That's the problem that is. And all of my fiddling around, I think, from the, also the different editions of this book, but also his essay on political regionalism, and also, you know, the studies of economic culture, have been various attempts to try as a kind of talking head, not a practitioner, academic, to, if you like, to give some indication as to what ground one could stand on, and as opposed to simply giving in to the pressure of this society expected in which we live. So the, you know, the problem for the architect is how to pitch it between answering to the real historical conditions, understanding what the limits of architecture are, and the limits of any particular project, and bearing in mind, I think, you know, the ethical and political kind of undercurrents that pass through our society. Thank you.
future, we have special relationship to Finnish architecture, and I believe that it's impossible to write the history of Estonian 20th century architecture without mentioning Finnish architecture once in a while, every once in a while. But now we are open to questions and comments. So, and the pair, sorry, I have to say the pair that we don't have a certain microphone. So you have to read and speak out loud. If you have a question or if you're somewhere near, then you have to come forward and I can give you the microphone. But you know, it is attached here to the wire, so I can't bring it over to me. Okay. You're welcome to have questions.
We'll be back then.
A bit. I have to.
It's all right. I can go out there.
I was told then, as it really goes. Okay, now I will have my question and then I'm going back to your beginning of the lecture about the questionnaire to the architects. You showed images of the Christian Peaks in these buildings, and he was the one who was supposed to answer the questionnaire. And I wonder if the Gilbert Williamson's buildings, they were from 1970s, early 80s? Yeah, and the questionnaire was from 1992. I wonder if he had to, as you mentioned, the question about urban history and architecture turned out to be a most disturbing or rather problematic question. I don't mean for Kulix, I don't mean for all the other seven or how many were. But I wonder if Kulix had answered the question of urban history a bit differently if he had done it in the 1970s, or at least when he designed the buildings. In terms of, I understand that the 1990s question about history was really driven from the position of how Venice Biennale presented history. But history in the 70s, and especially when you look at this neo-constructivist approach, treated history in more critical terms. Just one example is here in Estonia. We actually look quite proud of that development, neo-constructivist Tallinn School of Architecture, who used history very strategically in their neo-constructivist projects from the 1970s to intervene radically or critically into the existing Yes, but it's not only the Soviet issue, it's about issues of architecture as art, and the position of architect himself and so on. I wonder what was this kind of conceptual spine of Gullickson in his neo-constructivist aesthetic plan?
Yeah. Well, I don't think it was neo-constructivist, because I think that the modular house, which there were a couple of prototypes, was really, as I said, somehow coming off the, Konrad Glasman, Walter Gropius, general panel system house, where they also tried in the 40s and early 50s to actually mass prefabricate a housing system and market it in the United States. It was a total failure. They couldn't market it, because, and I think the same thing happened to the modular prefabricated system that Gulishan, Palasman, and there, there's a different line, I think, which is not really constructivism. It's related, I think, it's an interesting, I had a great deal of interest in this. I mean, well, it must begin in 53, I think, there's this building in Ulm of the hospital for Stadt in Ulm as a kind of new Bauhaus. And it is the beginning of a kind of industrial design methodology. They didn't have to have a department of building, specifically they don't have a department of architecture. They got into this same you know, that Hannes Meyer used. You know, he referred to his, like, for instance, in the project, the League of Nations in 1970, he says, our buildings are League of Nations. He would not use the term architect. And the old school had a similar position. And I think that that data, though I've never discussed it with Kuhn, or, but I know I should sometime talk about Hannes Meyer, that there was this, the thing is supposed to be a rational, productive system. They are trying to do a kind of a universal productive system for housing. And that's what Bartzmann and Robbins had tried earlier. And, you know, I suppose you can find, of course, in the total archive of Soviet avant-garde, some works that are sort of something like that. But I think the highlight of the main line of constructivism was freer, and more, was not so, yes, it was not so obsessed with production and rational production. But I mean, what happens, I think, with Kuhnism is that after that fails, he becomes somewhat conservative. That's why Sandy Wilson would distinguish between him and Cairo. Cairo was an architect of the skeleton frame, and Kuhnism was the architect of the wall, you know. Came more conservative in that sense. And that split, I think, apart from the Stockholm extension, you know, was maintained, you know, in the practice. I mean, if you look at the West End S-Crew houses of Cairo, they don't have much to do with, or anyway, they transcend Gullickson's work.
Mr. Lecture will never issue that for Gullickson. It was more about systems or some.
It was more about technology. You know, he felt, I mean, basically, he didn't say this, but not word for word, but you know, he felt that war architecture and he was very skeptical about new technologies or new building techniques. You know, that's all he had to say. You know, that he didn't think that they guaranteed durability.
Thank you. I have two simple questions. The one is, you said in the beginning of the lecture that Finnish architect was inspired a lot by Soviet architects. And can you please say more about it? Which hints with articles give you this feeling? Of course, indeed, they lost, but still, it's interesting. And the second one, what do you feel about our architecture? Just like what you feel, what you know.
Well, the first one, which is more tricky than the second question, I think. When you look, I mean, I think that. Yes, you know, he did these industrial plants like the Necco textile plant, for example, which is much more dynamic, I think, and freer, but using metal, of course, you know, in a very dynamic way. More dynamic than the what I referred to as the Anglo-Italian high tech. But it's coexisting in Europe. 72 is the central part of the new competition. And 73, I think, is that very Necco textile plant, you know. So, and he did other industrial plants, of course. But, and I mean, the only, I would take that Mary Necco thing in particular, but also the West End S-Brew houses, you know, which are, they have a kind of, you could say, cubistic core, but then they're overlaid with this, which has something to do with Alto, also you could say, but I think the particular dynamic of the glass conservatory and the trellises and the balcony and the spiral stair and all that, you know, is very, it's very playful and it's not heavy. The joints are not heavy; they're very light, you know, as opposed to slight tendency towards rather heavy rhetorical joints in the work of. Anglo-Italian high tech. I mean, I've been very unfair to, in a way, you could say, to Anglo-Italian high tech. I'm just trying to stress, you know, this moment of lightness, technological lightness in the world, of particularly Cairo. But there's something of that, of course, in the work of Pekka, I think. It seems to me that those two figures are very different. They could not be more different, and as you know, Cairo was no longer alive. It couldn't be more different as persons. It's significant that Cairo won't answer. You know, he's not present to answer the question. You know. That's not his game at all. He's a kind of street kid, I think. A rich street kid. With his leather jacket and leather cap. Yes. Well, that's the other one was out of, yes. Well, I have written a piece recently for somebody especially. Yeah, I feel very strongly that of all these kind of heroes of that moment, let's say the figures that were still around in the 60s, I mean, Mies, Le Corbusier, Alma, etc. I mean, I think that after 65, Le Corbusier died, and most of these guys a few years later, and Alma was a bit younger, of course, but I think of that kind of these Olympian figures. I mean, I think Alto is the one figure whose legacy can still be developed now. You know, I don't really think you can really develop Corbusier. You can't take Le Corbusier as a project about today. I'm not convinced about that too much. Or Mies for that matter. I think that maybe it's too subjective, what I'm saying. But I think that Alto, so that's one of the things I feel about Alto.
Thank you very much for the lecture. And my question is about Lou Kahn, who is quite a hero for Estonian architects. Could you comment a possible relation of his architecture to medieval fortification architecture in Europe? Can you see a possible relation between these two? Thank you.
Well, I mean, Lou Kahn is about, if anyone is about wall architecture, it's Lou Kahn. Basically. And I personally think, well, you know, I think it's also sort of documented that the primary inspiration for Kahn is Roman rather than medieval. And but the one building you could say we do know who was very moved by, which you could somehow connect to medieval wall architecture, fortresses, etc. Is Alban Cathedral. You know, there are particular drawings of Alban Cathedral. He has this beautiful thing, he said. Formerly, I mean, in Gothic times, they built in solid stones. Today, they have built in hollowed stones. And I think this idea of hollowed stone is, you know, a very beautiful aspect of Kahn's thinking. You know? I mean, if you take the Yale Art Gallery, which has the space frame in concrete, you realize that it's a crazy thing, the space frame in concrete, because they couldn't build it like that, because they wanted to put the service runners through the space frame. So it was built as inclined beams, and then the little triangular parts were sort of plugged in to give the illusion of a space frame. It's absolutely clear in that case, as a kind of early hollow stone game. You know, he does this tower with Anne Team for the American Space and Company Association, which are all tetrahedral. It's a tetrahedral space frame structure with the services going through the gut, you know, the apertures of the space frame. So I mean, I think this. Hollow stone metaphor is a very addictive to calm. How to develop calm, you know, today is I don't know, really. I mean, I suppose what I would say, you know, outer time is open to development, because there is a lightness and a kind of collage-like or montage-like capacity, which you know, calm doesn't sort of open to that, you know. It's very much more, more monumental.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
You can speak up also.
My name is Dani, I'm an architect. And what do you think about modular architecture from ship, ship containers, and are this idea is useful and still alive? What do you think about the future architecture made from containers?
Well, it's pretty rigid. I'm not very convinced about reusing containers. I mean, it's extraordinary when you think about non-renewable resources. I mean, these, it's obvious that rationalization of transshipping, you know, containers was the answer, right? And but then these mountains of containers all over the place. I mean, some is probably too critical to use, but God knows, I have no idea how to. But if one wants to look at, you know, it reminds me of something that, because it was a leftist intellectual, who's still alive, Thomas Malthus, who was a figure in this whole story. And he said once, it's very good comparison, while one cannot make anything without waste, this is distinguishable from the ideology of waste. I mean, I think it's such a, bit tricky, but I think it's, you know, and when you look at these containers, I mean, you know, we're so smart and all that, you know, but here they all are, these damn containers, and no one knows what the hell to do with them, you know, and this amount of steel is constantly being eaten, you know. Not a renewable resource. I don't think, you know, what is ends up as punitive to human beings, I think. I don't think you cut all of these damn things and have to mislead them.
Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you. It's already late. We're very pleased to have you here. And just a short note, don't run away immediately. We'll have a short, rather short opportunity to have a glass of wine. We have to, these will probably have a link here, but please, yeah, just step forward and we have our wine table over there. Thank you again. Thank you.